Well, thanks so much for joining us today. I'm Pastor Sharron Scott with Let Go and Soar Ministries. This is my husband, Pastor Walt Scott. We truly appreciate your time and your heart for joining us today. Pastor Walt is going to open us in prayer, and then we're going to worship together.
Greetings to everyone. Let's bow our heads. Father God, we just thank you for this day and another opportunity to get together. We thank you for the clear air and the great temperatures. We know the fires are almost out. And Lord, we just ask for this seasonal rain that we should be getting by now. We just ask for that and pray that we have an abundance of rain this year to bring the forest back to life. And just kind of a renewing thing, let there be rain. And Lord, we just, and for this time of the year, like my wife Sharron was just stating, that you didn't hear that out on YouTube, but for just reconciliation this year, and unity in the body, and let's not forget that everyone's our brother and sister, and we're called to love each other. And so I just ask that, and pray for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. So thank you so much for joining us for worship. Worship is so powerful. And I personally have received healings twice or three times during worship because of worship, not because of anything that I've said or done, but because God chose that time to heal me from a serious neck problem and from other things. So today, I would just like to speak into that as we worship. There are several people here, if not all of us, who have something in our physical bodies that needs healing. So if you could just not necessarily focus your worship, we always focus our worship on God, but focus your worship with the mindset that yes, if God chooses, He can heal. And what did Jesus say when the guy said, well, if you want to, or if you desire to heal me, and Jesus says, I do. You know, He always does. So open your minds to the possibility today that God might use this worship, this time of worship, to heal you. And I just declare that over you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I hear the voice of one calling. I hear the voice of one calling. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. I hear the voice of one calling. I hear the voice of one calling. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. Make his path straight in the wilderness, and let your light shine. Let your light shine in the darkness, and let your rain fall. Let your rain fall in the desert. I hear the voice of one calling. I hear the voice of one calling. Prepare ye the way. Precious and the honey sweet. So you love this city and you love these streets. Every child out playing by its own front door.
dreaming in their dead-end job. Every driver driving through the rush hour mall. I feel it in my spirit, feel it in my bones. You're gonna send revival, bring them all back home. I can hear that thunder in the distance, like a train on the edge of the town. I can feel the brooding of your spirit. Lay your burdens down. Lay your burdens down. From the preacher preaching when the well is dry, to the lost soul reaching for a higher high. From the young man working through his hopes and fears, to the widow walking through the veil of tears. Every man and woman, every old and young. Every father's daughter, every mother's son. I feel it in my spirit, feel it in my bones. You're gonna send revival, bring them all back home. I can feel that thunder in the distance, like a train on the edge of the town. I can feel the brooding of your spirit. Lay your burdens down. Lay your burdens down. Now victory is mine, and I'm amazed, so amazed at the way you love me. You are the rain falling again. You are the river when it all runs dry. There is no one like you. You are the sun. A fire in the darkest night. And you say, I'm the apple of, the apple of, the apple of your eye. I used to be so guilty till you won my case. I was scared of everything. Now I know I'm safe and I'm amazed. So amazed at the way you love me. You used to be a prisoner, now you call me free. I never had a song to sing till you sang over me, and I'm amazed. So amazed. this night. And you say, I'm the apple of, the apple of, the apple of your eye. A thankful heart we bring, a thankful heart we bring. We sing and sing and sing, 'cause it's endless offering. A thankful heart we bring, a thankful heart we bring. We sing and sing and sing, we sing and sing, sing. Jesus, Son of God, Son of Man, I call you Savior, with nail-scarred hands, you will be my son, in the morning light, bringing redemption. My dark night, beautiful surrender is where I want to be, locked into your arms for all eternity. Come and take my hand, you can lead me where you please. Beautiful surrender is chasing after me. I am beloved, full of faith, standing tall, confident and brave, ready to fall into your light. Voice that calls with no reservations. I surrender all. Beautiful surrender. Beautiful surrender. It's where I want to be. Locked into your arms for all eternity. Take my hand, you can lead me where you please. That beautiful surrender is chasing after me. La da 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 da
one more time.
I surrender all my heart and soul to you, my love.
Beautiful surrender.
Beautiful surrender is where I want to be. Locked into your arms for all eternity. Come and take my hand. You can lead me where you please. That beautiful surrender is chasing after me. Cross that you have carried. Thank you for the blood that was shed. You took the weight of sin upon your shoulders. Sacrificed your life so I could live. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the cross that you have carried. Thank you for your blood that was shed. You took the weight of sin upon your shoulders. Sacrificed your life so I could live. Now nothing is holding me back from you, Redeemer of my soul. Now nothing can hold me back from you. Your love will never let me go. Your death. Thank you for your death and resurrection. Thank you for the power of your blood. And I am overwhelmed by your affection, the kindness and the greatness of your love, the kindness and the greatness of your love. Jesus, you make all things new. Jesus, you make all things new. Thank you that we're living in your kingdom. Jesus, you're the king upon the throne. Thank you for the way you always loved me. Now I get to love you in return. Now I get to love you in return. Jesus, you make all things new. Jesus, you make all things new. the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you and to your careful hand. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. Make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I now surrender, you are breaking new ground. Make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Make me a vessel. Make me your vessel. Make me your vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. I came here with nothing, but all you have given me. Jesus brings new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. Jesus, bring new wine out of me. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. Sing that again. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. Sing it to him. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else. Nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
Lord, we thank you. Thank you that you created music and you gave us voices to sing. No matter what we think of our own voices, Lord, you think they're beautiful. We thank you for this opportunity to bless you today, Lord. We ask that you seal this worship today and that you bless the message to come and give people open ears and open hearts and open spirits to receive the word that as we dig into your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. So once again, thank you for watching. Today, I had a whole different message that I was going to be speaking on. And then yesterday, God just, I know that many of you who have been in the Word for a while will read something and suddenly it just socks you right in the soul. Your mind and your will and your emotions, and it just completely impacts you so differently. Or you've known it here, but suddenly it's here. So what I would like for everybody to do is just, let's put our attention on John chapter 17. Now, I will explain that John 17, 20 through 26 is a scripture that we base our ministry upon, and that its focus is on unity. But we're going to dig a lot deeper than that today. So, Lord, I just ask that you impress upon my heart and the heart of everyone who's watching and listening and everyone present today what it is that you want us to see in this verse and what you want us to hear in this chapter today. In Jesus' name, amen. When I began, I don't even know what specifically made me turn to chapter 17, except that maybe it was a who and not a what. So we're going to just read, and I'm going to stop here and there. And I did a lot of praying and a lot of looking things up, and I even went into the Greek and Hebrew. Brian, you'll be so proud of me, because, boy, I tell you, there's just some questions. Now, I need to hold up my Bible, what's left of it. I say that because lovingly, I call it my old friend. It is put together with packing tape in the back. It's the binding has come off, but I have the wide margin Bible, and I have written over the years different questions and remarks and comments. When we go to church, I will oftentimes write in, if a pastor has highlighted a verse, I'll write in the date and the name of the pastor and church, and that way when I refer back to it, I'll say, I heard something about this, and I'll look and go, oh, that's right. It just helps me. Some of these pages are so underlined and highlighted and commented on that it can be kind of hard to see the verses, but God gets through, amen? So let's just begin this. Jesus prays for himself. Now, who can tell us where Jesus was when this happened? The Garden of Gethsemane. If we look back just a little bit, then Jesus' disciples said, now I'm at 16, verse 29. Then Jesus' disciples said, now you're speaking clearly and without figures of speech. Now we can see that you know all things and that you don't even need to have anyone ask you questions. This makes us to believe that you came from God. I'm sorry, but you know, that just never fails to amaze me. Jesus says, you believe at last? Jesus answered, but a time is coming and has come when you will all be scattered, each to his own home. You will leave me all alone, yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace in this world. You may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart. I have overcome the world. So he's not specifically in the Garden of Gethsemane. This is before the very end of his life. So he is sitting and he's discussing a few things, saying that in the past I've been speaking figuratively, but now I'm going to speak very plainly because my time has come. And I want you to understand exactly what I have been saying. So he said, take heart, I have overcome the world. How many of us are grateful for that? Yeah. Come on. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed. Now it's very interesting. What is our normal posture when we pray? We bow our heads. Jesus lifted his head, which is very significant. He lifted his head to the Father. Father, the time has come. What time is he talking about? His end. His, yes. The reason he came to earth has come to a culmination, and right now he wants to pray. Now, he's not doing this silently. That's the other thing we need to understand. He's right in front of them, and they can hear every word he says. Brian.
It makes me think of when Jesus came to Lazarus' tomb, and he was about to pray to have Lazarus raised. And it says very clearly, I'm not praying this for my benefit to God, but for those who are around me.
That's right.
And I think that's significant in this also.
Mm-hmm. It truly is. The impact of this prayer of Jesus is, it should really knock our socks off, spiritually speaking. We really need to listen to this. Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. So here he's speaking of that intimate relationship, that oneness that he has with God the Father in front of his disciples. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. So he's speaking about having authority over all people, not just his disciples, but over everyone who inhabits the earth, right? Now, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ. Okay, stop there. You realize that he just said his own name with Christ afterward. Why is that important? Does anybody have any thoughts about that? To me, it's important because, yeah, his name is Jesus of Nazareth. Okay, that was his name. But he's putting his title, his heavenly title, after his own name.
I'm just thinking that in the original translation, it was actually Messiah.
Yeah.
And it was translated to Christ. And that Messiah is defined as the anointed one.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it's not an anointed one. Right. It's the anointed
right.
one. And so that, I believe, is what he's conveying in this prayer, mm-hmm. is he's saying, Jesus, your anointed one, the mm-hmm. anointed one.
Yeah. He's acknowledging his title of Messiah, which is Messiah, whom you have sent. Now, in just a little while, we're going to get into something that just, if I had not been sitting down, I would have been on my knees. Let's look at verse 4. I have brought you glory on earth. Now, when we see the word glory, and this is part of a little word search that I did, for our human and earthly purposes, you can also use the word honor. It's smaller than glory, but so are our brains. So in our spirits, we understand glory, but in our human minds, it can be somewhat hard to grasp. So that's what I did. Brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. So Jesus knew that he was here for a purpose, didn't he? And we know what that purpose is. We're going to talk a little bit more about that. And now, Father, this impacted me, this next statement. He is asking the Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Now, why did that impact me? Because he said, in your presence. Why would he say that if God was not present in that moment? Right there. Now, this might be one of those weird things that nobody else, you know, is impacted by. But he's speaking to the Father. He says, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you, here it is, before the world began. Not only is he stating that he is Messiah, or he is Messiah, or he is Christ, but he is acknowledging that he knows that he was there with the Father before the world began. Do you even imagine what kind of impact or confusion maybe this had on his disciples. What did you just say? Before the world began? But I think they were almost used to him making statements that they didn't quite grasp. Because he just explained to them, okay, I'm going to speak plainly, and then he says this, right? We know that Jesus is not a liar. We know that every word that he that is in the book that we're looking at, the Bible, the Word of God, is truth. So he says, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Jesus had glory before the world even began. Jesus prays for his disciples. Let's move on a little bit. And he's still speaking to the Father in the presence of the disciples, full knowing fully that they're right there and they can hear every word he says. And he's not putting on a show. He's speaking to his Father, which, by the way, was not common back then. I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. They were yours. You gave them to me, and they have obeyed your word. Did they always obey God's word? No, no more than we do. They're human, but they were chosen. So that can be some comfort. Remember, next time you mess up, yes, I'm human, but I'm also chosen. He says, now they know that everything you have given me comes from you. For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. Now understand, he's not talking about the word of God in paper or whatever form, tablet form. He's talking about the spoken word. Yes. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. He waited to say this, you understand, until they said, this makes us believe. Now we're looking back at verse 16:30. This makes us believe that you came from God. Right? So now let's fast forward back to, for I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. So he's praying for who right now? He's praying for his disciples. It's important to understand that. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. So there again, we understand that Jesus' understanding of who he is far deeper than the disciples could grasp. Far deeper. You jumped ahead. If we think about it and we read these words, we can't grasp it either. We really can't. All I have is yours, and all you have is mine. What an amazing statement to make about, if I were him, about myself. Everything God has is mine. Whoa. But there was no ego, and there's no pride in this. He's stating fact, okay? And glory has come to me through them, his disciples. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world. And I'm coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, this name you gave me. Okay, we're going to have to go back over that because it's bigger than it looks. Okay. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I'm coming to you. So, Jesus, here's another thing that someone might ask is, well, how did he know he was going to God? Because he was God. Yeah, he knew that. Well, you know, that's part of the world's confusion. Well, how did he know? Well, because he was God and man. Okay. I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. Now, let's look at this a little bit farther. Okay. I'm at verse 11 and 12. Okay. Well, let's back up just a little bit. I apologize. There was a point that I wanted to make, so hold that thought. Let's go back to verse 4. I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Okay, I did comment a little bit on the term glory. Okay. The glory which I had with you before the world was. This prayer could not come from Jesus if he were not Yahweh himself, equal with the Father. So in Isaiah 42, verse 8, let's look that one up, somebody, please. Isaiah 42, verse 8, and 48, verse 11.
That is my name. I will not yield my glory to another or my praise to idols.
So there God states what? That he doesn't give his name to anybody. Only God can have that name. And 48:11 says,
for my own sake, even for my own sake, I will do it. For how can my name be polluted? And I will not give my glory to another.
So he won't give his name to another, and he won't give his glory to another. And Yahweh proclaims, that he shares his glory with no one. If the Father and Son share their glory, they must both be Yahweh. Isn't that astounding? So, all right. Let's get back to where we were. And we went through 11. Let's go to 12. While I was with them, I protected them and kept them safe by that name you gave me. Okay. And this is why I went back and then came forward. The amazing thing is, Jesus, and this is a little bit of a conundrum for me. Does anybody else find conundrums in the Bible? I think, Brian, you have another name for that word. Serendipity or, yeah. My not confusion, but what I'm still ruminating on is Jesus is praying to the Father. He's on earth and he knows he's leaving. Where is he going to go? He's ultimately going to be going to where the Father is. Okay, I think I know what the answer to this is, but I'll just take you along a little journey that my brain went on. So he said, he's asking that the Holy Father protect them by the power of his name, Father God, the name you gave me, so that they may be one as we are one. And what question came up in my mind was, but if Jesus is God, if he has the same name as Yahweh, why is he asking the Father to protect the people when he leaves? What Holy Spirit showed me was, directly after the crucifixion, when Jesus gave up his spirit, where did he go? I'll ask you again, where did he go? No. Immediately, where did Jesus go when he left the earth? He went to Hades. There was a time, you see, the span, that little glimmer when Jesus went to hell to redeem the souls that were there. Yes. So that to me might be, I'm no Bible scholar, I'm not a theologian, but that might be why, because he didn't want his disciples and his people to be left for one millisecond without protection. Because remember, Holy Spirit wouldn't have come for quite a ways talking more than, not quite 2 months. Okay, yeah.
I would like to share just something real quick that was on my mind from the Strong's, just the definition of the name Jesus, which is a derivation of Yeshua, okay? And that means literally Jehovah is salvation. And putting that into all that you have just said, it begins to shine a light on on that.
Right. And we're going to, I think we're going to be talking about the name Jehovah in just a little bit. Let's see. Okay. He said, by the name you gave me. So right there, he's saying that God gave him. And originally, I think in 2004, I wrote down what name? Is he talking about the name Jesus? Is he talking about the name Messiah? No, that's not a name. So there's where I started digging in, and I discovered, well, he's giving him his name. So none has been lost except the one doomed to destruction. Who do we know that to be? Judas. So that scripture would be fulfilled. I'm coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. So here, Jesus is giving us what God gave him. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. Isn't that cool? My prayer is not that you take them out of the world. Yeah, that's not the way Jesus wanted God to protect them, because they needed to stay. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. And again, in about 2004, I wrote in there, why does he have to ask God to do this? Well, and I kind of have come to, and I'm in the process of coming to that answer. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. He says again, sanctify them. What does sanctify mean?
Separate.
To separate or to make holy. Okay, set apart, make holy. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. Now, there's another fundamental statement in Christianity that came straight from Jesus' mouth. Your word is truth. Right there, folks. Okay? As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. Now, just rest on that for a minute. So Jesus was before the earth. God sent him into the world for a purpose. Jesus is now sending us into the world for a purpose, each one of us separately, differently. Okay, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans for a hope and a future. Every one of us has a very specific purpose. And what Jesus is saying there is that God sent him to the world for a purpose. And now Jesus is doing the same thing with us. Think about that, folks. For them, I sanctify myself. I set apart myself and I make myself holy. He was our example and still is in the Word. He is our example as to how to live, sanctified and holy, set aside, that they too may be truly sanctified. So isn't it interesting that being sanctified is a choice? It's not just something that God gives us. He could. Do we receive it? Do we choose to walk in it? Jesus prays for all believers. Now, so we're transitioning from him praying. Actually, he started praying, I want to say, for himself, then for specifically those present, his disciples. And now he's transitioning. And remember, he said, I'm not praying for, I can't find it. I'm not praying, oh yes, here it is. I'm not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours. So that's in verse 9. So now he's praying. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. So the amazing thing is how do they have a message? Have they read the Bible? What message is he talking about? The gospel of Jesus Christ, right? They have that message. Up until this point, Jesus has been giving them the message. They have received it, and now they are giving it. Okay. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. Who is that? It's us. We believe because of this message. Where did this message come from? Oh, some guys, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, you know, Peter. We are still to this day, thousands of years later, believing in him through their message. How impactful is that? What other book on the face of the earth has impacted so many people over thousands and thousands of years? There is none. None. That all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. Now, this is where it really started to get me. And yes, I've read it I don't know how many times. But really, let this sink in. Think about this again. All of them. So who is them? I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. Now, this takes us to the realization that Jesus knew this is a totally foreign concept to any Jews back then. Jesus knew that Father God was in him. So any other Jews hearing this would have said, well, first of all, they would have wanted to stone him for blaspheming. And that's happened before. They didn't stone him, but they sure wanted to. He just kind of walked away. No, not my time yet. He knew that the Father was in him. That's amazing. It just is. May they also be in us. And I put, not that I'm adding to scripture, for my own, whatever you want to call it, I put that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I in you. May they also be one in us. I put the word one in there because it helps me to realize what it is that Jesus is saying. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. Now, what this did for me was it helped me to understand that Jesus is in me, but he's not encapsulated in a bubble. And, you know, I've realized this for a while, but Jesus is in every cell in your body, every atom. Jesus is all-encompassing. Okay, he's not in a pocket somewhere, unless you put him there. I should maybe put that little caveat in there.
I apologize for saying this maybe at this time, but because it took this long for something to sink into my head.
I get that.
You know, as you go down, all you know how you're talking about something, you go, oh, there's something there, and yep. then now you're down the page about a half farther, you know, but back up where they said that for them I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. Mm-hmm. The word meaning separated. Mm-hmm. It has And then reading the rest of it that you just got done reading brought to mind that when we separate ourselves from the world because we are part of, we are Jesus. I mean, we are not Jesus, but Jesus is in us. We have opened ourselves up to all the things that Jesus did and remembering all the things that Jesus said to be able to walk in that. Mm-hmm. And this is where it gets a little bit interesting to me, is that why Jesus was able to walk through crowds and not be seen. That's why Jesus was able to make wine, you know, at a wedding festival. That's why Jesus was able to do things that we as humans cannot do, because we at that point were not walking with Jesus. But once we became sanctified and separated, we became not just in the world, walking in the world, we became like Jesus. And when we became like Jesus, we could do all those things. And I know that we think of, like, what do you mean we can disappear and walk into a crowd without people seeing us? You know, what do you mean that we could make wine at a wedding festival? What are you saying? And what I'm saying is, those are the things that maybe we don't walk in right now, but those are the things that when we became sanctified, the door was open for us to do.
Right, in the supernatural. And I also want to, you mentioned something else, that we're not Jesus. We are not him, but we are who he is. Do we all understand that? Okay, we're not Jesus. Nobody's gonna say that we are, but we are who he is, especially to the world. And to each other, by the way. Well,
that's why it says that they may all be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you.
Yes. Right. Yeah. Right. So, continuing on, this idea of being in Jesus, we can accept easily, well, not easily, but we can kind of accept as we walk our walk, that Jesus is in us. That Holy Spirit is in us. You know, it really is, it's one of those moments we can accept, but understanding fully, yeah, that's a work in progress, I think. So, I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. Now, what did we say? Glory is a position. Glory is honor. Okay, honor and glory are two different things, but conceptually, they're very similar. Okay, in order to be one as God the Father and Jesus are, we have to be established in a position of honor. And that is what Jesus has done. I in them and you in me, may they be brought to complete unity. Now, we're not talking about, and I made mention of this before the service today, I'm not talking about everybody agreeing. You don't have to agree to be unified. But you do have to be of one heart to be unified. The body of Christ is so divided right now over such, forgive me, but foolish and ignorant things that do not matter. Unity means we are of one heart. We have one focus, and that's Jesus Christ. And that is what we are focusing on, not what the world wants us to focus on. We are focusing on Jesus Christ. And Walt, you had something?
Well, you kind of said it there. I'll just reiterate. Jesus is the primary focus of a Christian's life, mm-hmm. Nothing else. And that's what keeps us unified and should keep us unified.
Mm-hmm. That's why we sang the song, Nothing Else. I just want you, nothing else. Okay. May they be brought to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Now, folks, considering the lack of unity, especially within the body of Christ, it's no wonder that the world does not believe. What does it say? That the Father sent Jesus and have loved them even as you have loved me. So they don't believe because we are not exhibiting that. They look at the body of Christ, and speaking of the world, they look at the body of Christ and they don't see unity. They don't see love. They don't see peace. Not corporately. They may see little pockets of it, but to the world, that's hypocrisy. And that is not what Jesus is praying for here. Terry Sue, you had something?
Just one phrase. It's very simple. Love God. Love people. That's it?
That's right. Not things. What I have heard is love God, not things. Love people, not things. You know.
Excuse me, but I tell people that the gospel can be summed up in four words. Love God, love people.
That's right.
Like Terry Sue just said.
That's right. That's right. So we are to love each other just as God has loved Jesus. That may seem like a lofty goal, but Jesus never gave us anything to do that we weren't capable of doing, because he always gives us what we need to do it. Father, Jesus says in verse 24, I want those you have given me, now we're speaking of the disciples here, to be with me where I am. It was so important to him that when we leave this earth, when we graduate, that we be that they are united with him again. That's love. And to see my glory, the glory you have given me, because you loved me before the creation of the world. There it is again, folks. You loved me before the creation of the world. I have something that was revealed to me when I read that I'm going to reveal to you. That's not just Jesus, folks. That's you too. What? It's the absolute truth. Because God loved you before the creation of the world. God knew you before the creation of the world. He designed you. He made you. And he loved you before the creation of the world. And in closing, Jesus says in verse 25, Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. So Jesus just said that the world does not know him, does not know the Father. And Brian, you have something?
A confirming verse, Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5. Says, I chose you before I
yes.
formed you in the womb.
Right.
I set you apart before you were born.
Right. Right. And it goes back even farther than that. It's before the world was even formed. So, the world does not know you. I know you. And they know that you have sent me. So, the world does not know you. I know you. And think about that for just a minute. It was so foreign at that time, not only among Jews, but among the Gentiles, that anybody could know God personally. What? I mean, you could have your head cut off for saying such a thing. How could you possibly know God? You're a mere human. And Jesus says, the world does not know you. I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made, now when he says they know that you have sent me, speaking again of his disciples, I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them and that I myself may be in them. If it doesn't blow your mind, that last statement, then you're not camping on it long enough. The concept that the creator of the universe, the creator of the world, lives in me. Do you really believe it? Do you really, truly believe that God lives within you? I want to put that out there as a challenge to you. So we are to share glory as the body of Christ. We are to share the love of Christ. And if that gets hard sometimes, it's because you've slipped out a little bit of living as Jesus lived. Get back into it. I don't care what anybody else says. We should only care what Jesus says. And we should only treat others as Jesus would treat them or does treat them. Okay? Now, that's one last point. If we have the glory that the Father gave the Son, remember that it was a glory that often appeared humble, weak, and suffering, and was ultimately displayed in sacrifice. We don't like that concept, living sacrificially. Yes. If we have the glory that the Father gave the Son, remember, think about it this way. How did Jesus live? Okay, God the Father gave him his glory. Let me rephrase that so you totally, hopefully, get it. God the Father gave Jesus the glory that God the Father had. Do you get that? Okay, it's big, and he gave it to Jesus. Huge. And yet Jesus washed the feet of his disciples. Jesus was humble. He was weak and suffering when he was fasting for 40 days, was he not? And he was ultimately was the greatest sacrifice that anyone on this earth ever made. The most important one as well. So I hope that you will go back in and read this. And if you have a notepad or if you have a Bible like mine, you'll go back in and read this again and let God really speak to your heart. Dig into it, because this is the love of Jesus for you. This is how very much Jesus wants for us to be in him. If you ever, well, maybe I was going to say a little baby person. You just want to hug them and you just want to kiss their cheeks. They're just, you know, we're not little. You know, we have a new granddaughter named Willow. She's about 18 months old. And you see babies and you see their little cheeks and you just want to, you know, you just want to eat them up. But Jesus, that's earthly love. Jesus has so much more. He just wants us. He wants us more than we could possibly understand. This prayer shows you that. You have something, Walt?
Well, what always was, it's not hard for me to understand, but what always kind of amazed me, and still does, is this last part of verse 23, where it says, "You have sent me and have loved them, us, as you have loved me." God is love, of course. He sent his one and only Son, whom I know, it just says he loved him so much for us because he loved us so much and was willing to see him die on the cross like that.
That's right.
For us.
That's right. That's right. Just recently, I've heard in a few different ways something that's kind of, how does Bill Johnson put it? Oh, faith offends the stationary. It's Bill Johnson. You could be offended by this, but not. I think it's one of those statements that people make, and it just kind of hits you, and you think, wait a minute, how am I supposed to feel about that? But when God looks at you, he sees Jesus. And God loves you exactly to the depth that he loves Jesus. Now, that is one of those statements that could offend people. Well, I'm not Jesus. Well, we already had that discussion. Yes, Brian.
The thought occurred to me that the only reason we might get into a fence is because we want to be in control of what it is we believe.
Go figure.
As opposed to submitting and saying, if you said it, God, it's true.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. So the stakes of the unity that Jesus prayed for are very high. The spiritual unity of Christians is linked to the way the church represents Jesus to the world. The spiritual unity of Christians is linked to the way the church represents Jesus to the world. Oh boy, that's a sobering thought. So there's so much more, there really is, but this is a great chapter, and this prayer that Jesus prayed, the activation of it can only be done by us. How? Well, we have to live as Jesus lived. We have to be who Jesus is. We have to unify. We have to love as he loves. We know how to do this, folks. But our ego and our pride and our ignorance gets in the way of us walking the walk that we are supposed to walk. Yes, selfishness is all a part of that. So do you want to live your life the way you want to live it, or do you want to live your life the way Jesus wants you to live it? That's the bottom line. Until that happens, this prayer of the man, the God, who loves us so much, is never going to be answered. And that's sad. Terry Sue, you had something.
Well, the body of Christ reminds me of a playground. There's all kinds of different things on the playground. There's slides, merry-go-rounds, and tree forts, and all kinds of stuff. Teeter-totters. Each one of them is different, but they're all in the same playground. One's not better than the other. The monkey bars aren't better than the slide, but they're all together in one place. Mm-hmm. So let's play nice.
Let's play nice. Let's play together. Yeah, that's a good word. So to end this, what I would like to do is just, first of all, for everyone who's watching, purify your own hearts. Simplify your life. Get rid of all of the junk. And it's simple, but it's not easy. It's simple. All you have to do is get rid of all those things that don't look like Jesus. If it doesn't sound like Jesus, if it doesn't look like Jesus, it's not Jesus. Another way of looking at that or saying it is, if it doesn't look like love, it doesn't sound like love, and it doesn't feel like love, then it's not love. Jesus is love. If you don't know the love of Jesus, oh, my friend, I want you so very badly to understand it's so easy for you to get that love. It's important to Jesus. You are important to Jesus. He wants you to be in him. You heard the words. He wants to be in you. Pray for a better understanding of that. But before you do anything else, please just talk to God. Talk to Jesus and say, Jesus, I just am not feeling the love in my life. I want to. I want you. Please help me by coming into my heart, coming into my life. And surrendering all that I am to Jesus. Surrender everything that you have to him, and that makes him your Lord. Asking him to come into your heart, that makes him your Savior. Both things are very important. And when you do that, and you do it with all your heart and in sincerity, we believe that you have just joined our family, and we welcome you with love. Excuse me. Gonna have to edit this. find a faith-based church and get around people who will show you that love in a non-condemnatory, non-critical way, who will welcome you with open arms and show you just exactly who Jesus is. God bless you. Thank you for watching. And we hope to hear from you soon. Bye-bye.